Well, praise the Lord. Amen. Is this a happy day for you guys? Praise the Lord. We're in the house of the Lord. And we don't have people out there with guns trying to keep us from coming in. We don't have the devil standing at the door. If he is, he better run, because we're spirit-filled. Hallelujah. We're glad to have you this morning. We'll keep Chad Barger in prayer. He went on his business trip and came back with a bug. That nasty bug. So he'll be watching us online this morning. We miss him, and we want him back soon. Praise the Lord. So let's open in prayer. We got a full day for you. Father, we thank you and praise you for this day. Father, we welcome you into this house. We welcome your presence, your healing, your power to just engulf us. We thank you for that. We come expecting to receive from you this morning. We give you praise and glory for it. And all God's people said, yeah. Amen.
Greatest day in history. Death has beaten, you have rescued me. Sing it out, Jesus is alive.
Man, he's not dead.
The empty cross, the empty grave. Life eternal, you have won the day. Shout it out, Jesus is alive. And he's alive. When I stand in that place, free at last, meeting face to face, I am yours, Jesus, you are mine.
Yeah, hallelujah.
Endless joy, perfect peace, earthy pain finally will cease. Celebrate, Jesus is alive,
yeah.
And he's alive. And oh, happy day, you wash my sin away. Oh, happy day, I'll never be the same. Oh, happy day, you wash my sin away. Oh, happy day, forever I am changed. And oh, what a glorious day, what a glorious way that you have saved me. And oh, what a glorious day, what a glorious name.
Thank you, Jesus, for what you've given us. Have a seat and watch the announcements.
Hey. Glory to the Lord. Oh, our God is good. Amen. Amen. Are y'all excited about who you are in Christ? Well, good. Praise the Lord. Turn the lights on, please. Hallelujah. I like to see who I'm talking to. Well, there you are. All of a sudden, I see your shining faces. Praise the name of the Lord. Well, today we're going to do what we did last week. We're going to have you bring your tithes and offerings forward. And just want you, when you bring them forward, give with a purpose. Amen. As a man purposes in his heart, not the amount, but what you are going to do. What seed is that for? Amen. So praise the name of the Lord. Just play some music for us, and we'll have everybody bring them forward. And Chris, you're going to come pray over the offering.
It's on. Good morning, guys. Good morning, Rock Church. How are we doing?
Awesome.
Well, I got the opportunity to come up here and pray over the offering again before. But before I do that, I got a testimony that I want to share with you guys about my lovely wife over here, who's so modest that she won't tell you this. But long story short, she works in escrow, and so she was contacted by another title company trying to get her to come over to there. They offered her $5 an hour. $5 an hour more. I'm sorry, not $5. They offered her $5 more an hour, a minimum of $1,000 a month commission, and a $20,000 signing bonus. And that's amazing in itself, right? And I don't say this to brag by any means, but it gets better than that because she loves where she works. And so she gave her employer the opportunity to just move a little bit. And so we prayed over it, and they matched it. They matched everything. And we're not special by any means. This is just a testament to what God can do if you just sow your seed.
Amen.
Okay? So let's pray. Father, I come to you right now. We thank you for this opportunity to give, Father God. We ask that you grow it, you multiply it in your most holy name, Father. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Amen.
Praise the Lord. We're going to have to give Chris another testimony, Lord, so he can pray a little longer so the team can get up here. Praise you, Jesus. We're used to Gary, and he kind of goes a little long. Where are you? Praise the Lord, Gary. Why don't we stand up, and let's praise God.
I wanna hold the hand that holds the world. You are the only the name of Jesus. From age to age you reign. Your kingdom has no end. We lift our banner high. We lift the name of Jesus. From age to age you reign. Your kingdom has no end. You are the only king forever. Almighty God, we lift you higher. You are the only king forever, forevermore. You are victorious. You are the only king forever. Almighty God, we lift you higher. You are the only king forever, forevermore. You are victorious.
Spirit was moving over the water. Spirit, come move over us. Come rest on us. Come rest on us. Like the Spirit was moving over the water. Spirit, come move over us. Come rest on us. Come rest on us. Come down. Spirit, you make my heart pound. When you fill the room, you're here and I know you are moving. I'm here and I know you will fill me. Come down, Spirit, when you move, you make my heart pound. When you fill the room, you're here and I know you are moving. I'm here and I know you will fill me.
how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles. Jesus. This is how I fight my battles. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. This is how I fight my battles.
God, that's how you fight it.
This is how I fight my battles.
Jesus.
This is how I fight my battles.
Yes, Lord.
This is how I fight my battles. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. This is how I fight my battles. 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 This is how I fight my battles.
One more time.
It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you.
There's angels everywhere.
It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you.
Give it all to you.
It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you.
Come to the altar, the Father. Compares to you. Lord God, you've rebuked the enemy. You've opened up heaven to us. You've written your name on our fleshly hearts, Lord. A name that is above every name.
Hallelujah.
At the name of Jesus, the enemies flee. We thank you, Lord God, that you have empowered us from heaven. You have given us the Holy Spirit. You've given us your Son and the word of your power. Oh, we magnify you, Lord God, because of who you are and what you do in our lives. We're so thankful. We are so thankful. Said we are so thankful.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah, that our names are written in the Lamb's Book of Life. We are so thankful that you made us more than conquerors, overcomers in this world. We're so thankful that when we act in faith upon your word, the results of heaven pours down great blessing into our life. So, Father, we thank you and we praise you. We ask you to bless our time. Father, we pray that our praise and worship touched your heart. And we gave it out of sincere hearts, Lord God, that you are now inhabiting to teach, to instruct, to heal, to deliver, to give guidance, to rebuke the devourer. We thank you, Father, right now in the mighty name of Jesus. And all the saints said,
amen.
Amen. Well, give somebody a big hug. Give somebody a big hug. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Praise the name of the Lord. Children, you are dismissed. Amen. And happy anniversary to Ricky and Luli. Amen. She's back there. 1 year anniversary today. Praise the Lord. Amen. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Well, praise the name of the Lord.
Yes.
We serve a great and mighty God.
Yes.
You know, he teaches us how to be overcomers,
yes,
how to live in the success of his kingdom.
Yes.
Amen. So today we're going to continue on living in success, or success in living. Amen. I'm glad you're all so excited. If you caught hold of last week's message on tithing and giving, and you're actually putting that into work, things like which happened to Chris and Amber can happen in your life. God just opens up the storehouses of heaven and blesses you. Amen. So today we want to look at some other things that we need to do in our lives. How you know we do it by faith? It's not a work of the flesh. Amen. It's not a work of a mind of a man. It's the work of the mind of Christ inside of you, the heart of God inside of you, standing in the faith of His Word. Hallelujah. And how many know every time you hear His Word has faith in it. His Word is faith. And it can empower you to be that overcomer if you let that Word really renew your mind. Again, the only thing we have to do is let it renew our mind. How do we do that? We believe. And once we believe, what do? We start to put action to it because we believe. I've said this 100 times to you. If I buried $1 million out in the parking lot and told you to go find it, how many of you would actually believe that I put $1 million out there? First, you'd have to believe that. Some of you are saying no. Well, then I'm sorry. You're going to miss the blessing today. Hallelujah. But how many, if you really believed I'd planted $1 million out there, would go put some effort into it trying to find it? You'd watch? Well, watchers don't get to participate in the reward, though. Hallelujah. So you can watch me dig up my money, and it'll stay my money. Hallelujah. It's actually His. Hallelujah. I want you to open your Bibles to Joshua chapter 1 today. We're going to look at what God declared to Joshua and how God said He was going to be successful in living, successful in life. Hallelujah. I mean, you know, you can take the Word of God to heart. Yes. Amen. Now, this is old covenant. We have a new covenant. Amen. But we want to watch and look at what the old covenant said, because it's so important to us. Because the book of Joshua, if you were to break it down, you would break it down in two sections. One section is conquest. The next section is distribution. Amen. So basically, he's telling Joshua that he's going to go forth and he's going to do battle. But as long as he has his eyes on the Lord, he's going to win. He's going to conquest. When you win over the enemy, you get to distribute all you got from them. Amen? Amen. Thing in the kingdom of God, when we win over the enemy, we get everything that God gave us because the enemy can't hold it back anymore. Amen. Amen? I mean, you want everything that God has for you. Amen. Hallelujah. Well, if you want everything God has for you, you have to believe every part of His Word. Amen. Can't throw some of it out. You got to believe it all. Amen. So we're going to read here in beginning verse 1 and go through verse 9. After the death of Moses, the servant of the Lord, it came to pass that the Lord spoke to Joshua, the son of Nun. See, if you think you had bad parents, he had none. Hallelujah. Moses' assistant saying, Moses, my servant, is dead. Now therefore arise, go over this Jordan, you and all of this people, to the land which I am giving to them and the children of Israel. I mean, you know, your Lord died. Moses died, and he's giving an inheritance to Joshua. Joshua represents Jesus Christ. Amen. Jesus died for us, and he's bringing an inheritance for us. Hallelujah. Every place that the sole of your foot will tread upon, I have given you, as I said to Moses. So the same promise that Moses received, Joshua received. Moses represents God the Father, Joshua the Son, Jesus Christ. Everywhere Moses tread, God said, now you can have it. Well, everywhere God treads, our Father treads, we can have it. I mean, you know, He's all over the earth. Hallelujah. The gospel of Christ has went all over the earth. And so, folks, God wants you to understand there's a covenant promise that wherever you go, the promises of God are going to flow. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. As long as you're being obedient to God and following His directives, and when I say that, it's just living by faith. Amen. Living because God is ministering to you. He's answering your prayers. He's speaking to you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Glory to God. So he says, I'm going to give that to you. Every place at the sole of your foot. Have me walk. Man, I say, when I read this scripture, I say, everywhere my tires flow. How many, I don't walk like they used to do in those days, amen? But everywhere my tires go, I got dominion, amen? And everywhere my feet go, I have dominion. Praise the name of the Lord. So he said to them, from the wilderness and this Lebanon, as far as the great river, the river Euphrates, all the land of the Hittites, to the great sea toward the going down of the sun shall be your territory. Amen? I mean, who knows the enemy is a hitman. He used to belong to the Hittites. It's going to be funny today if you'll catch the jokes. I know they're dry, but they're good. Hallelujah. In the land of the Hittites, he said, all the way to the setting of the sun. So that means every one of us in Bakersfield can own everything from Bakersfield to the beach. So the church is moving next week to Pismo Beach. So God is saying, listen, as far as your eye can see, you're going to have the blessing of the Lord in your life. I mean, you feel like you're having the blessing of the Lord in your life as far as you can see. You know, some people can't see very far. Amen. They're called nearsighted. Bada boom, bada boom. There you go. He says, as far as you can see, basically, I'm going to bring blessings into your life. The thing is how are we concentrating our mind on the things of God? Are we just looking in the natural and saying, this is what I see in the natural, and I want a response from God in the natural? Or are you dreaming dreams and having a vision from God, and are you looking to what God can do in your life rather than what the system seems to be giving you? I mean, you know, this system today is failing us. I mean, you know, this system today is not only failing us, it's wanting to take what we have. But God says, can you see beyond the systems of this world and see the system of the kingdom of God, that where you're at, God can absolutely bless you? That you're not tied to this economic system and you're not tied to the government system of this world. We are tied to a government, the government of heaven. We obey the laws of this land to get heaven's favor, amen, as long as they don't ask us to sin against our God. Amen. They ask us to sin against God, we'll all just say no. Amen. We're going to stand for what God's word says. Amen. But God says, as far as you can see, and that's by faith. Where is your faith taking you? What are you reading in the word of God that has given you a new look at your future? Amen. Last week we talked about giving. He rebukes the devourer and opens the storehouses of heaven. Amen. Can you see the storehouse open? Can you see the enemy no longer coming against you? Can you see what the word says will happen in your life? Can you see that by the stripes of Jesus you are healed? See it, envision it, making sure that you realize that the gift of God is divine health. You have to see it. You have to have a vision. My people perish for a lack of vision. They're destroyed for a lack of vision. He says, when you have a vision, write it down so everyone can run with it. When you believe that God is your healer, write it down. Let it resound in your heart and in your mind. See yourself whole no matter how you feel. That's when faith energizes and takes you to the next level. Hallelujah. If you're letting your situation determine what's going on in your life or what your future looks like, then you're looking to the flesh. You're looking with a carnal mind and not with a spiritual mind. Amen? I mean, you know, California is the most beautiful state in the United States. But how many know California is not a great place to live because of the tax structure and all the laws that are coming into this land? But folks, I don't live in California because it is a natural state. I live in California because this is where God placed me. And if God placed me, I'm going to prosper here, no matter what the world does, no matter what the system wants to take from me. They can't take away all of the blessings of my God, because my God can outdo them hand over fist. My God is more abundant. My God is more powerful. My God will meet my need. So no matter what's going on in your life, and I say this because many people are struggling with their finances or their health or their marriage or their children's situation or their job situation, whatever it is that you may be dealing with that brings trouble or torment into your life, you have to realize that there's a God who has said, I'll take you, I'll bless you as far as your eye can see, even to the setting of the sun, as you can see by the eye of faith. By your belief in what God's word says. Hallelujah. So as he is speaking to Joshua and describing a natural land, he's also describing what the new covenant is in Christ Jesus, that when he died for us, he gave us heaven and all of its blessings. And all we have to do is find those blessings, stand in faith, believe, act upon those blessings because we believe, and watch the blessings flow in our life. Amen. Hallelujah. Praise the name of the Lord. He says, no man shall be able to stand before you all the days of your life. No enemy, no man can stand and stop what God is going to do for you. You see, so many people are making decisions because they're afraid of what man is going to do to them. In the New Testament, the word of the Lord in Matthew chapter 10 says, don't give any thought of what man can do to you, but honor me because of what I can do to you. Amen. Amen. Folks, we need to get our eyes off the trouble in the world and get our eyes on the blessing of heaven. Get our eyes on what faith can be produced inside of us and what mountains faith can move for us. I'm glad you're all so excited. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. No man, all the days of your life, no man can stand between you and your God. Isn't that right, Clara? Amen. James and Christian got a tremendous blessing this week. Man wanted to come against them. We prayed, and man could not utter anything against them. Could not come against them and do what man wanted to do. But they found the freedom and the victory that is in Christ Jesus. As I was with Moses, so I will be with you. Hallelujah. Jesus said he's never going to leave us or forsake us. He's always with us. Lo, I am with you always are the exact words of our Lord and Savior. Amen. Low and high. Lo, I am with you. I just love that because I know what he means, but I always like to give my little twist on it. He's with me in my lowest spot, and if he's with me there, I know he's with me in my high spots. All right. Hallelujah. Because the first thing that comes to mind in the natural man is, where are you, God? As long as you're asking God, where are you, and why aren't you talking to me, why aren't you doing something, you're declaring, I have no faith in God. You're declaring out of your own mouth that God has shut up, and God did not shut up. The word of God says, heaven is never quiet. God is always speaking. The angels are always praising, except for one half hour during tribulation, just before he pours out his wrath upon this earth. The rest of the time, God is speaking. The problem is you're not tuned in. So the God says to us, he says, I will be with you. Amen? Just like I was with Moses. How many think that God with Moses was pretty awesome? Hallelujah. How many think the miracles that Moses did through God, through the power of his word, was pretty awesome? How many would like to go out to the ocean and say, you know, hit it with a rod and it just parts like that? Woo, glory. I think that's pretty awesome. How many like to throw some dust in the air? It becomes alive. How many like to have a cobra that can swallow the cobras of the enemy? Moses, God was with Moses, but the most important thing God was with Moses is that God led Moses.
Not the miracles. The miracles are a part of the leadership of God. Too many times children of God are looking for the miracle when they're missing the leadership of the living God. He is to lead us, and that's why in the new covenant, God gave us the Holy Spirit to lead us. So that as we seek him, he answers, he directs us. Praise the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. So he says, I will never leave you nor forsake you. Be strong and of good courage. Everyone turn to someone and say, you're courageous. You have good courage. Good courage is courage that does not fail. Good courage is courage that does not grow weak. Good courage is, I'm standing, I'm going to overcome, and that settles it. I can do it because Christ is with me. And if God is for me, who or what can be against me? Hallelujah. So he speaks to him about this and says, the power of God is going to be inside of you. And good courage is courage that is led by faith. You absolutely know God's going to see you through. Because that's who our God is, a God who will see us through. A God that if he has to, will carry us through. Hallelujah. A God who will rebuke the devourer for us. A God who will open our minds to see him, to hear him. A God that will order our steps, and we'll see the steps by the way he answers our prayer. We'll see the things that God has given us. Folks, I don't know about you, but I wished that I heard God in everything I wanted to do. But many times I pray a prayer and I see God answer it, and I know that's what God wants me to do. You can't stand in front of a burning bush every day. But every day you can watch how God is moving and answering your prayers. Every day you can watch how the Word of God is coming alive. Every day you can watch how the fruit is being produced. Amen? Hallelujah. Every day, if you've gone the wrong way, you'll feel the conviction of the Holy Spirit. Hallelujah. God is moving. So he says, be of good courage, for to this people you shall divide as an inheritance the land which I swore to their fathers to give them. God has an inheritance. What's the New Testament covenant say? You have an inheritance in God. Amen. It tells us to know what the inheritance we have in God is. What is the power that is given unto us who believe? Hallelujah. It tells us to know that, to experience that. Hallelujah. I'm the only one in this whole room saying hallelujah. Hallelujah. Only be strong and very courageous. Now he's added something to that. He said you're of good courage. Now he says be strong and very courageous. In other words, the battle may endure for a while. And you're going to have to learn how to stand in faith until you get my directive. Until you see me open the door. Till you see me answer the prayer. Till you see me move in your life. Amen? That's why in the New Testament says, he who endures until the end shall be saved. He who has a strong, courageous spirit. Amen? Very courageous, who's willing to stand on what God has led them into. What God has promised us. Oh, come on, church. He's promised you everything unto life and godliness. Are you all looking at me? You see, I have a smile on my face. Because he gave me everything unto life and godliness. You should have a smile on your face. Because you have everything unto life and godliness. Well, Pastor, it don't seem like it. Well, that's your problem. You're waiting for a feeling and you're waiting to live by sight, but the just shall not live by sight, but by faith. You have to believe it's there whether you see it or not. You have to believe it's yours whether you feel it or not. Hallelujah. We live not by sight, not by what we're seeing and feeling. We live by the promise of a living God that we can't see until it's made manifest. But as soon as God shows us it's ours, we believe and we receive. Amen. Hallelujah. So he's telling him, he says, you're going to be strong, good courage. And then he says, you're going to have to be strong and very courageous.
that you may observe to do according to the law which Moses, my servant, commanded you. Now here, he makes this strong and this courageous, this very courageous. He applies it to what you want to be courageous in. Fighting for the truth. Living for the word of God. Overcoming the powers of the enemy who wants to deceive you, to get you caught up in sin, to take you down a path you should not go. Amen? Yeah. He's saying you're going to have to be courageous because the flesh would rather surrender if it seems easier. Amen. And the flesh would like to do some things that are sin because it feels good to the flesh. Amen. And the mind would like to do some things because we think it's going to get us out of trouble. So we'll tell a lie to get out of the trouble we're facing. How many know we just made the trouble double trouble? Amen? So he says, you're going to have to be strong and very courageous to act upon my word and to be obedient. Thank God for the new covenant, because now we have the Son, we have the Father, we have the Holy Spirit, we have the written word of God, and we have the living word of God that comes inside and changes us. His name is Jesus. So now we have leadership. Now we have the power of heaven to make the right decisions to overcome. Hallelujah. I mean, you know, you still have to make a decision whether you're going to sin or not. You still have to make a decision if you're going to do this or that. And how many of you know that there are a lot of people wonder what this and that is? Because this and that can be your desire, or this and that can be that which God prophesied, that which God spoke in his word. You have to start looking for what is that which is spoken in the word of God. Not what is in me, but what is in the word of God that is truth and power and life-changing. Hallelujah. So you look into the word. This is successful living, folks, because you'll overcome all the power of the enemy. You'll have conquest over the enemy who wants to guide your flesh and put things in your soul that are not of God. In the New Testament, it says, we have weapons of our warfare, and they are not carnal, but they are mighty to the pulling down of strongholds. Therefore, take every evil imagination, every thought that's not been given to you by God. It's evil, no matter if it sounds good. If it's not been given by God, it's an evil thought. Take every evil imagination, bring it in submission to God. Take every thought and bring it in submission to God. Everything that exalts itself above the knowledge of God. The knowledge of God is, he says, I will lead you. So if you're not being led by him, you're being led by the devil, by self and flesh, because God says, I will lead you. So he says, take everything. You're going to have to be courageous, and you're going to have to fight to keep your mind focused on Christ. To keep it focused on what God wants for you. Again, folks, when you're hurting, it's hard to stay focused on healing. Let's be honest, folks. When you're hurting and it goes, oh, it's hard to stay focused on healing. You might say, oh, thank you, Jesus, I'm healed. But you have to have a revelation of that healing. And revelation is hard to lay hold of when you feel the pain. That's why many people in marriages, their marriages fall, because they are getting hurt in their marriage, and the hurt has greater revelation to them than the revelation that God says, I can sanctify this marriage. So you have to settle your heart in, I'm going to get until my spirit is sanctified in this area of my life so that I can fight the fight of faith, endure and win, because God gave it to me. He just wants me to believe his word above everything else I'm experiencing. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. When we do that, you're walking in faith and you're successful in living. Praise the Lord, because God will open doors you never dreamed of. Again, Amber and Chris, they tithe, they're good givers, they're ministering to our youth. They've been in ministry for many, many years at the other church they were involved in. And you know what? They weren't even asking God to give them such a blessing. But what does God do when you're doing it the way God wants you to do? Blessings catch up with you. The word of the Lord says they overtake you. You don't have to go looking for them. They come looking for you. How many would like to have God's blessings come looking for you? How many would like to have them hunting you down? I would love to have more blessings hunting me down. Amen. I've had many blessings come in my life, and I got many more to come. But I, you know, God, if you want to give me the double portion, that's okay. Because I believe in a God that can increase and increase if I have the joy and the faith to believe that God is the God of increase and not subtraction. And he can increase you wherever you're at. In mind, he can increase you no matter where your mind is at. In heart, he can increase you no matter where your heart is at. In finances, everything God can bring in, God's the God of increase. Hallelujah. God just wants you to believe that you have a great and awesome God. Amen. And that's what God is speaking into Joshua. He's going to become the leader of God's people, Israel. He had already spoken it into Moses, and Moses was living by it. Amen. But how many of you know even Moses didn't live 100%? But did Moses get to see the power of his God? Did Moses get to see Israel delivered? Yes. Hallelujah. Folks, listen to me. God wants to deliver you from all of your afflictions. Whether they be financial, mental, socially, whatever they are, God wants to deliver you from everything the tormentor is doing to you. Amen. Hallelujah. But you must believe. It's called believing. And people say, I believe. But then they immediately kill it by saying, oh, how are we going to live through this month? I don't have enough money. You just killed what you said you believed. If you believed it, you would say, it doesn't matter. My God's made the way. If you really believe, you'd say, it's okay. I'm a giver. I've been given. God, I got harvest coming in. Glory to God. It doesn't matter that the enemy stole anything. He has to repay me 7 times what he stole. Glory to God. I got more coming in. If you really believe, what comes out of your mouth will sound like you believe. It will sound like you believe. And if you don't believe, get into the word till you do believe. And let faith arise inside of you for that area of your life. Hallelujah. Yes. Praise the name of the Lord. He goes, again, this book of the law shall not depart from your mouth. This book of the law shall not depart from your mouth. In other words, you should be speaking the word of God continually. Yes. Again, I want you to evaluate yourself. When trouble comes, what's the first thing you think about? Do you think about victory or go, oh my, oh me, what are we going to do? The first thing enemy wants to do is he wants to steal your faith. So he comes with the doctor's report. You can't believe the report of the doctor. You have to believe the report of the Lord. If you believe the report of the doctor, even though he may be 100% accurate of what's going on in your body, if you believe that report, you will give more value to that report than by the stripes of Jesus you are healed. So you believe by the stripes of Jesus I am healed. The doctor has now given me what I need to pray about specifically so that I can have the report of the Lord, not the report that he just gave me. All the doctor does is he tells you what you need to pray about, what you need to have faith over, that which you need to have conquest over, that you might find the distribution of the healing power of God. Amen. After conquest always comes distribution. If you study war throughout all the time of man, whoever won the battle got everything that nation had. Well, God created this world, and he created it for his good pleasure. The enemy has stolen it, and God says to the church, go back and take back my land. Everywhere you put your foot shall be your inheritance. Take it back. Take back what the enemy has stolen from you, and have faith and stand in God and believe that God can do the impossible. Listen, if he can raise the dead, he can fix your body. If he can raise someone who already stinketh, decay is already set in. And he had to die from something. Lazarus died from something. He was sick. Something in his body wasn't working right. Well, God raised him from the dead. And when he raised him from the dead, he didn't have the same sickness. He raised him from the dead whole. So if God can do that, he can heal your sickness while you breathe. He says, have faith, believe. If this word does not depart out of your mouth, when you start questioning God, God says that's a lack of faith. You can ask God, God, give me revelation, give me wisdom in this area. But if you're saying, God, why aren't you? God, I need you to do this, I need you to do that. You're questioning God's own word. Because God says, I know your need before you speak it out of your mouth. You should be asking me for wisdom to speak the word, that you might speak the word over your own problem and find the answer in heaven. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. This book of the law shall not depart from your mouth, but you shall meditate in it day and night. Now, folks, how many of you, when you face a problem, sort of meditate in the problem day and night? Hallelujah. You can meditate on the problem, or you can meditate on your own desire, but if you're not meditating to get the wisdom of God, those things overwhelm you. Those things will take you into darkness. God's word takes you into light. God's word takes you into the promise. God's word takes you and fills you with faith. People will tell you, I have faith. Well, James says, show me your faith by your works. Amen. Says, that's what I'm going to do. I'm going to show you my faith by my works. If I believe God, I'm going to act upon it. I'm going to get up off of this bed. I'm going to act like I got money. That doesn't mean you lie, and it doesn't mean you write a check you can't cover. Amen? You have to have integrity. I'm going to act like I have money. Honey, I know we can't get that today, but bless God, within the next 15 minutes, maybe God will give it to us because we're givers. So we're going to stand, honey. Honey, do you want, I don't know what you want. You want a house at the beach? Sure, okay. You can say, I don't have the money to buy it, or you can say, you know what? We need to ask God first if that's God's will that we should buy a house at the beach. And then we'd start thinking, well, we got, 150 people in the church. If they all want to use it, oh my gosh, we'll never get to use it. We'd have to ask God, Father, is that wisdom from heaven? Is it an investment for us? Is it something you want us to do? If God says yes, then guess what? God will provide the money. If God doesn't provide the money, you got the answer. Hallelujah. I said, you got the answer. Praise the Lord. We took a whole bunch of people, 20-some people, down to Guatemala to evangelize the nation. And we got to the airport. We'd been praying to be in first class because we had gotten so many tickets. Charlton worked for the airlines. We got buddy passes for 20-some people. We got down there, and they said, man, the plane's overbooked. He said, we'd sure like to be in first class. I mean, our God is a first class kind of guy. Yeah. Hallelujah. So just before we're supposed to board, the stewardess comes over to us and says, Mr. and Mrs. Barger, we got you in first class. Hallelujah. The rest of our team didn't get first class. And we looked, you look at them and say, well, you should have been praying. You should have asked God for wisdom, because I was going to minister for hours and hours and hours, and I needed the rest on that plane flight. Now, you can't rest very good in coach. First class, man, that's the way to go. Oh, God gave us first class, and then my armor bearer, he said,
Pastor, but I want in first class with you. And the hostess at the gate said, no, you can't have first class. He gets on the plane. He walks up in first class and sits down, and the stewardess comes and says, sir, you don't have a ticket to be here. I want to be up here with my pastor. He kept on and kept on until she said, go ahead. Listen, if you know what God wants for you, you persist. But you persist with joy, and you persist with the confidence that it's God. God will make a way for you. Oh, come on, church. Hallelujah. This law of the book shall not depart from your mouth. The only way it won't depart from your mouth if it's in your heart. Out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks, the new covenant. Amen. So if I'm putting the word of God in, that my God is a blesser of his children, that my God provides my need, that my God heals my body, that my God is with me, then I'm going to act like my God is going to do all of that, and I'm going to believe. Because I'm going to ask God to give me the wisdom on how to attain that in my life. It's called, again, faith. It's called the Word of God coming alive inside of you. Amen. I've shared this before, but when I was in Guatemala another time, I was doing El Calvario's World Conference, 3,500 pastors from all around the world coming in, and I was teaching. I was the only teacher. I taught from 8 in the morning till 8 at night. 8 o'clock at night was my last service, went till 9 o'clock. The day before, we went out to El Milagro, which was the city dump of Guatemala City, where 50,000 people live in garbage. We went out there and we ministered to a little church that was in the middle of the dump, the city dump. They had never won anyone to the Lord in 15 years. And we went out and ministered to the people in the dump and brought back 200 born-again believers and said, here's your new church. Hallelujah. We went out and ministered, so they said, well, Pastor, we want to bless you with a meal. And so their water was poured into big barrels, and they had little things swimming through it, and it was green and mossy. It was not clean water, but that was their drinking water. And so they made me some punch out of that water. How many of you know that punch had a great flavor? Yeah. Man, it had the flavor of Jesus. Hallelujah. They made me some potatoes they didn't cook all the way and some food they cooked in that water. And so I ate it and I got a parasite. Amen. It wasn't a pair of glasses that gave me sight. It was a parasite. And I could feel that thing eating me. How many of you have ever had a parasite while traveling? I'm telling you, it feels like, you know, the alien is inside of you. Just going around, just stirring around. Well, I'm sick as a dog that night. And I get up in the morning, I got to go preach from 8 in the morning till 9 o'clock at night. 1 hour, 1 hour, 5 minute rest, another hour, 5 minute rest, hour, just like that the whole day. I'm sick. You know, it's one of those things where you're coming at both ends. I'm dehydrated, I'm sick, but I claim the promise. Nothing shall by any means harm me. I can eat anything. Because I'm honoring my God, because God says when you go into a foreign land, eat whatever they put in front of you. And I ate it to honor them, because if I said, I can't eat that, and my translator said, Pastor, don't eat that. I said, no, they're trying to honor me. I am going to eat it, and my God will be with me. I got to the church that morning. I was sick, 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 and I preached, and I felt good for 55 minutes. 5 minutes, I felt like death warmed over. Preached for 55 minutes, another 5 minutes, feeling terrible. Preached another, preached till 9 o'clock at night, and that parasite was dead. Why? Because I wasn't going to stop from believing that my God is able to deliver me. That my God said, if I honor him and honor those around me, blessings coming into my life. Sure, did I have to go through something? But you know what? God affirmed that in my heart so strong that when I was in India with Mark not too many years ago, and they gave me fresh fried chicken and beef and beans and rice, which is a special meal in India. Everybody eats rice every day. They honored me with that meal. The next day, they gave us the same leftover chicken because they cooked enough to last for 4 days. They have no refrigeration. There's no place to put it. The second day, flies were on it. The third day, flies were on it. The fourth day, flies with maggots were on it. Do you know what? I said, I've already eaten parasites and them parasites have died. So I'm going to eat, and I ate, and I never got sick. Mark got sick, but I didn't. I said, Mark, you're going to have to grow in some faith, my brother. I truly believe, folks, that God is a God when he promises, he'll bring it to pass. And his promise is that you have to have the word of God coming out of you. It has to be flowing from you. It can't be something you're trying to stuff in right now. Amen. Something you need to have. How many of you know when trouble comes is when you need the power? It's too late to try to get the power when the troubles come. That's why the church has to go find somebody else that has the power to pray for them. But the church is supposed to be living in the power, which means you're continually putting it in, so it's continually flowing out. And like last week, you're always planting seed as you're speaking, acting upon the word of God, so you have harvest coming in all the time. Oh, come on, church. Hallelujah. You shall meditate on it day and night. It means you're going to think about it, that you may observe and do according to all that is written therein. God says you can live in all of the word of God. Some are good in finances, but not so good in health. Some are good in health, but not so good in relationship. It's because how many know you eat in the natural what you like? How many venture out every time you go out and say, I'm going to try something new? Or do you go, we're going to the same restaurant and get the same one or two items you always get? Because you know those are good. And you have an appetite for them. Hallelujah. We go to the coast, we go to Jocko's Steakhouse. We go to Brad's to get halibut and chips. We know what we like and we go to get it. Why go try something new when I already know what I like? Well, the thing is, in the word of God and in the body of Christ, we get scriptures that are our favorite and we never journey out past those scriptures. People don't study and just take the word of God and tear it apart. They live within a framework that they've already built. And that framework may not allow you to experience all of the blessings of God. That's why God's word in the Old Testament says extend the stakes of your tent. Expand them, put it out, make your tent bigger. Amen. The more you put in the word of God, you're making your abode in Christ bigger. You're letting God be a bigger God in your life because you're taking the word of God, all of it, writing it on the fleshly tablets of your heart by the Spirit of the Lord. And now you have a bigger comprehension of what God has promised and what God will do. And now the battles come and you already know you're a winner. The battle comes and you already have the wisdom. The battle comes and you already have the knowledge. The battle comes and you've already planted seed because you've been confessing God is your provider. God is your healer. God is the sound mind. God is the power. God is the love. God is my life. God gives me vision. God gives me hope. God gives me encouragement. God rebukes the devourer. Hallelujah. And so all of a sudden the battle comes and the battle don't look like no big thing. Because you already know what the answer is. Hallelujah. That you might be able to observe, to do that is all that is written in the word of God. Then you will make your way prosperous. There's the success. How many want your way prosperous? Now, prosperous doesn't just mean financially. It means in every area of your life. It actually means you'll have a sound mind. Amen? I mean, how many have ever done anything crazy? Amen. Praise the name of the Lord. How many of you, your spouse sings to you, crazy, I'm crazy for thinking about you. I don't sing that to my wife because I ain't crazy. I'm in love with her. I'd rather say I'm in love than I'm crazy for thinking about you. Because she could interpret that wrong. Thinking, what do you mean you're crazy thinking about me? You telling me you don't want to think about me? But if I say, honey, I love you, you're always on my mind and in my heart. Hallelujah. Amen. God is saying, listen, the word is there. It's alive. And you can observe it all. You can do it all. Because God's going to speak. God's going to answer prayer. How does God speak? Moses, the burning bush. Yes. Paul raised him from the dead. Yes. Peter gave him a vision. Yes. Simeon at the temple answered prayer. God speaks in many ways. Amen. Don't let the framework of your life cause him only to be able to do it one way, or you won't listen. For then you will make your way prosperous, and then you will have good success. Hallelujah. Good success is in every area of your life. How many have ever noticed some movie stars? They got it all, but they've been married 22 times. They got it all, but a good marriage. They don't have that. How many have noticed their kids go wild? You can have it all and have absolutely nothing. Amen? I've seen people poorer than anyone I've ever seen in my life, and they're having good success because they're trusting God every step of the way, and God is with them, and they're happy even in their poverty. They're happy because God is always making sure they have more than enough. Good success is a mind that doesn't dwell on the things that you feel you're lacking in. It dwells on the things you have in Christ Jesus. Doesn't dwell on the things of the desire of your flesh. It dwells on the things of the heart of God. Hallelujah. That's when you have good success. Have I not commanded you, be strong and of good courage? Hallelujah. He's already said this three times. How many think God's trying to get this across to us? Verily, verily. In this case, verily, verily, verily. Three times he said, be of good courage to do the word of God. You see, folks, I want to say this to you. People will come to church and they'll leave a church because they don't think they're growing in the church. But folks, if God planted you in a church, if you're not growing, whose fault is it? The church or you? It's you. If I don't grow, it's my problem. It's not your problem. If I'm not studying the word of God and growing, then I got a problem. And I can blame it on all of you. If they'd just do what I said, all the church would just do what they're supposed to do, we'd be a big church. I'm not supposed to look at you and say, you're the answer to my success. You're not the answer to my success. And I'm successful whether we have 10 people in here or 10,000, as long as I'm doing what God wants, teaching what God says to teach, and loving the way God says to love, being obedient to what God does. I'm successful. And that's the way you need to feel, because people have a way of measuring their success. God has a way of measuring success. Are you obedient to me? Are you studying the word and putting it in? Are you following after me? Do you know my leadership? Do you know what I'm saying to you through various ways? Be strong and be of good courage. Do not be afraid. Fear is a killer. Fear will drive you away from God's answer. Fear that you're not going to get something you want will drive you away from God who has something for you. Fear will cause you not to step out in faith and do what God's asked you to do. I mean, you know, when God came to Gideon, what was Gideon's first response? Who am I in all of Israel that I should rise up and conquer the Midianites? For my family is the least of all the families. We have less money, less anything than anybody else in Israel. God, can't you find somebody else but me? He was afraid till God built confidence in him. Amen?
Amen.
Moses was in fear. God, why would you choose me? I already failed in Egypt. I was next to Pharaoh. I could have set God, your people, free. I had authority. I had power. I killed a man and I'm thrown. Now I'm a shepherd on the backside of the desert. Who am I that you would choose me? Well, see, all of you can come up with all the excuses you want why you can't do what God's told you to do. How you are incapable, not enough faith, failures in your life. Or you can concentrate on what God is saying to you and say, God, if that's what you want me to do, then I know you'll be more than enough to make sure that I can do it.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Quit looking at you and saying, I'm weak. If you go study all the great men of God, every one of them said no to God at first. Some of them said, we're not rich. Others said, we don't have enough authority. Others said, we're the least number in our tribe. They had every reason in the world. They all sounded good. And God said, hey, guys, there's one thing about this. I'll be with you. Quit measuring what God wants to do based on you. Quit measuring what God wants to do based on what you have, based on who you think you are, based on failures of the past, based on you can't see the future. Make a decision to follow what God is telling you to do. And you can find where God is speaking if you want to look. Have I not commanded you, be strong and of good courage, do not be afraid, nor be dismayed. I mean, you know, the enemy likes to put up a sign that makes you dismayed. He likes to do something to get you to turn and go the other way. Amen? Whether it's something that looks fearful or the biggest ball of twine in the world on Highway Interstate 40 that gives you a detour. You know, we need to get off of this road. We're headed down here to do this, but the biggest ball of twine in the world. And you get dismayed by it. Dismayed means distracted, pulled away from, intimidated by, or drawn by. Hallelujah. Do not be dismayed. Don't be drawn away, for the Lord your God is with you wherever you go. Hallelujah. Praise the name of the Lord. Isn't that awesome? Praise the name of the Lord. Ephesians chapter 2:10. God says to conquer. Now, what did they conquer? What did Joshua conquer? You're sitting in this church and you know what Joshua conquered? The 31 principalities? 31 territories he won. Amen. Hallelujah. We'll go over it again because you must have lost your minds. Verse 10. For we are his workmanship created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. Good works are the ability to distribute all the blessings of the kingdom of God. He's made you so you conquer over the enemy, so you can do his good works. Boy, church, I don't know. Am I boring? Man, you need to get excited. God said, you were created in Christ Jesus for something. Good works. You can't do good works unless you've conquered the enemy that's been holding you back from doing the good works. You do that by believing the promises of God. What Jesus accomplished on the cross and in his resurrection. Which God has prepared beforehand that you should walk in them. Amen?
Amen.
Now what did Joshua and Israel conquer? I'm going to just give you 31 things they conquered. God won't talk about the principalities. Things love of money. First thing they conquered, the love of money, materialism. The next thing was they got over the fear of destruction and despair. The next thing they lost, gave away, was the security in their goods. They realized their goods couldn't make them secure. What you have can't make you secure. They conquered the wisdom of men. They conquered self-reputation, the love of sin. They conquered the ability to distribute the sin they walked in. In other words, they didn't invite people to sin with them. They overcame greed, self-righteousness, fear, and self-protection. They overcame religion, because we don't have a religion. We serve a living God. They overcame condemnation, the false way of flesh, the insecurity that causes us to withdraw. They overcame being branded by their past. They overcame false gods. They overcame the rejection of morality and began to live holy lives. They overcame shame and guilt. They overcame the pride of life. They overcame self-esteem and prosperity in the natural. They overcame false stature. They overcame being self-made. They overcame anger and judgment. They overcame fascination to things in this world. They overcame the cheater and the abuser in this world. They overcame the when we want to punish ourselves for what we have done. They overcame being consecrated to sin. They overcame unusual grief. They overcame the curse in the world. They overcame the cycle of life, and they overcame the fear of death. All the things you have to overcome. That's why the New Testament tells us, pick up your cross and follow Christ and die to self. You die to self, you die to all that stuff. Now prosperity in the world is just tools for the kingdom of God. Now everything in the kingdom of God is flowing and blessing you because you have let faith cause you to win over the enemy. Then comes the distribution of that. Go forth and make disciples. Be blessers, be givers. Hallelujah. Ephesians 2:10, amen. For we are his workmanship. You didn't make you. And who you have become may not even be the work of God. May be the work of flesh, may be the work of the enemy, but who you are in Christ Jesus is who you are in God. And we're to work that out, get that out. So who we are in Christ is what everybody sees. See, so many people are wanting something else in life. They think they'll be satisfied with another slice of life, something that they feel is better. That's called greed. If you can't get it where you're at, you're not going to get it where you're going. Because you ain't got it with you, you can't take it with you. And if you haven't learned how to get it here, you ain't going to learn how to get it there. Have you ever heard it's greener on the other side of the mountain, then you get over there and it ain't? You may have green grass, but you also have terrible snowstorms and tornadoes and everything else. So, you're his workmanship, created in Christ for good works. Are you doing good works? Are you doing good works? Yes. I'm teaching my kids to watch television while I sit on the couch eating potato chips. That's why I'm a couch potato. Are you doing good works? Hallelujah. Good works should satisfy your soul. If good works aren't satisfying your soul, you're looking for something other than God to satisfy your soul. Then let's go to 1 John chapter 4 and verse 18. Hallelujah. Blessed be the name of the Lord. 1 John chapter 4. How many want to be successful in your life? These are keys for your life. Verse 18 of chapter 4. There is no fear in love, but perfect love casts out all fear, because fear involves torment. Folks, one of the ways of knowing what God wants for you is that there's no fear in your life. Fear that if I don't do it, I'm going to lose something. If I stay, I'm going to lose something. If I go, I'm going to miss something. If I do it, I'm going to gain something. I tell you, folks, you can think yourselves into anything. The enemy is the one who brings confusion. If there's any confusion, it's not of God, it's of hell, for God is not the God of confusion. He says, there is no fear in love. That means you have absolute confidence of faith to do what you're going to do. Amen. To do what God is asking you to do. To be that believer who will stand up and have strong courage and very, very strong strength in God.
Hallelujah.
Amen. Because when there's no fear, there's no confusion. When there's no fear, there's peace. There is no fear in love, but perfect love casts out all fear. In other words, perfect love casts out all doubt and unbelief. Because doubt and unbelief is the root system, if you will, of fear. I wonder what's awaiting me. I wonder what's going to happen. You're making a statement. It's not a wonderful thing I'm thinking of. I wonder. I'm meditating on what's going to happen. Why don't we meditate on God's word? You don't have to worry what's going to happen. There is no fear in love, but perfect love casts out fear. Because fear involves torment. The soul is in torment. If it's in torment, it's in darkness. If it's in darkness, it's in torment. But if you know what God wants you to do, you can do it with great joy. And everything you do, you should do with great joy, with expectancy from God. When you're sick, you should expect with great joy the healing power of God. When you're in financial doubt, you should expect your harvest to come in. But he who fears has not been made perfect in love, has not matured. You're not mature if you're in torment. You're not mature if you're double-minded. Doesn't matter what you think about yourself or what you think others think about you. If you're double-minded, you ain't mature. You got to know that you know that's what God wants. You got to know that God wants you to prosper financially. You got to know that God wants you to do this or that. You got to know that by the stripes of Jesus you're healed. You got to know above anything else. It's called faith. Without that, you'll be in torment. But he who fears is not made perfect in love. We love him because he first loved us. Hallelujah. It's about falling in love with Jesus. You know, the Ephesians were great teachers. The Ephesians were great followers of God's rules and ordinances in the church. They were able to discern false apostles. They were able to do all this, but Jesus said something. I got one thing wrong that I have against you. You lost your first love. You're so into doing, you forgot to do the thing that's important. You're so into doing acts and patting yourself on the back, look at what I'm doing, you forgot to fall in love with the Lord Jesus Christ. You forgot to keep that fan flamed. You forgot to keep adding coals to the fire. You've walked away from your first love. Even though on the outside you look like a magnificent church, Ephesus, I still have one thing against you. You've lost your first love. And he says, go back to when you were born again and start to refresh and renew that which set you on fire at first and get that fire back ignited in your heart. If you don't have a fire, it's because you're not fanning the flame. I don't care. You can say, I pray and I study and I do all this. You're fanning the wrong flame because your prayer and your study is all about what you want God to do for you rather than falling in love with him. See, I can love Charlene. And I can love Charlene because I say, wow, you know, when I first saw her, she was walking down the street singing, do-wah-diddy-diddy-dum-diddy-doo. She was walking down the street. She had a low-cut top. She was 17 years old. She was in high school, East Bakersfield High School. She had on a short skirt. She's got long, beautiful legs. Still does. Hallelujah. Well, see, when I first saw her, my flesh said, hubba, hubba, hubba. My flesh said, woo, I like that. But then I heard God's voice say from heaven, that's the girl you're going to marry. Now, I could have married Charlene and said, honey, I'm going to love you as long as you're pretty. Long as you fulfill my needs, I'm going to love you. Long as you cook, wash my clothes, keep the house looking nice, I'm going to love you. Long as you say yes to everything I say and everything I want, I'm going to love you. How many of you know that wouldn't have lasted very long? Now, folks, I never cut all my hair off because I have a very uneven head. I've got craters in it. It's not because she hit me on the head. I was born that way. But listen, we love each other because we want to please one another. We want our love to be a love that encourages one another. Our marriage has lasted 50 years and on 51 years. Our relationship's over 52 years now. Why? I think she's just as beautiful as she was the day I married her, and if you got anything to say about that, we'll fight. She's just as beautiful. Why? Because I married the inner girl as well as the outer girl. Well, see, I gotta fall in love with Jesus and love the inner God as much as I love all the blessings of God. I gotta love all of God. And see, the last days it says the church will wax cold because the church isn't getting what it wants from God. It's not loving the heart of God. It's just wanting the blessings of God. So it's walked away from God's protection and God's provision. It's walked away from the perfect love that casts out all fear. It's walked away and it's walked into torment. It's exactly what God told Israel. He said, the prophets have taken you off of the hill of my holiness to a mountain of self. And there the devil can take you anytime he wants you. Because it was all about what I want rather than what God wants. It's because I'm in love with his promises. I'm in love with what he has said I can have. Well, folks, in all this teaching we're telling you to believe God for what he says you can have, you got to keep your heart focused on who he is. The reason to do what he's asking you to do is not so you can be all that. It's so he can be glorified. When Chris told me the testimony that they had, I said, Chris, would you share it? Because the church needs to hear about you loving God and being obedient, joyfully obedient, and watch what God does for you. But we need to have God glorified for what he did. The purpose of the testimony wasn't to say you can all get $20,000 signing bonus. I mean, you know, some people just heard that, woo, man, I want that job. I've never got a signing bonus. In fact, they told me I had to pay to buy materials. Some people will just click in on that. Oh, man, I can get $5 an hour more and $20,000 signing bonus. Oh, man, oh, man, oh, man, oh, man, oh, man, that's good. Or you can hear the heart. We love God. We've served God. We believe God. We've trusted God. We've acted upon his word. And look what our God has done. He's an awesome God. So, 4:18 tells us, look, he's trying to give us a measurement of whether we're living successfully. Is there any fear? Any torment? Are you confident you're living the way God wants? Are you confident you're hearing from heaven? So there's no torment in you whatsoever. You have the peace that passes all understanding, able to guard your heart and your mind, because you're maturing in Christ, understanding what the kingdom is and what earth is, making the division between God's kingdom and the earthly kingdom. The earthly kingdom right now is crumbling. God prophesied it would crumble. Why should that be a surprise to anybody? Why would we be surprised they want to take all of our money? Why should we be surprised they want to kill all the unborn babies? And right now in front of our Senate is a bill that just passed the committee to kill babies 28 days after they're born, that you can take your baby back and say, I don't want it, kill it. Why do you think the world has gone nuts? God said he would turn them over to the delusion of their own mind and their own heart, that they would bring diabolical sin and wickedness upon the face of the earth, because Satan is being moved across this world through his powers of darkness. Why would we think anything like that and be afraid of it? I'm not afraid of it. It tells me my Jesus is coming. It tells me the church is going to be the greatest light in the midst of the darkness. Why would I fear anything that the world does? For they can't take my salvation away from me. They can't even shut my mouth. They take my tongue off and I'll go, I shall tell you that Jesus is Lord. God wants the church to be strong. Hallelujah. Final scripture. Good, not one final amen. Hallelujah, we'll keep going. If you wanted me to stop, you should have said, praise the Lord, hallelujah. He's on his last scripture. Verse 44 of Acts chapter 7. Our fathers had the tabernacle of witness in the wilderness as he appointed, instructing Moses to make it according to the pattern that he had seen, which our fathers, having received it in turn, also brought with Joshua into the land possessed by the Gentiles, whom God drove out before the face of the fathers until the days of David, who found favor before God and asked to find a dwelling for the God of Jacob. Hallelujah. Moses had been appointed and instructed. It was given to Joshua. Again, God had it. He gives it to Jesus. Jesus has now become the tabernacle. Jesus is the building, and guess what? You're the building of the living God. You are the temple of the Holy Spirit. You are the abode of God. In the temple was God's presence. In the temple, Israel could get wisdom. In the temple, God would declare the defeat of the enemy and the victory for Israel. Folks, you are the temple. Declare the victory for you, the people of God, and declare the enemy defeated by the power of a living God, by the wisdom of God. Shut down the thoughts that are not of God that are driving you into darkness and just center in. God, what do you want me to do this day? He said, give no thought for tomorrow, for today has enough cares of its own. He said, live for today, for tomorrow your life may be required of you. So many people can't live for today because they're caught up in their tomorrow or caught up in their past. Cannot give themselves to God because they are in turmoil and they are not mature according to the word of the Lord. But church faith has come into the house of the living God. Faith has arisen upon his children. The glory of the Lord is shining upon us. Our children shall come from the north, the south, the east, and the west. Noblemen and kings shall come to the glory of God. We are the church of the Almighty God. We are more than conquerors and overcomers in Christ. It's time to start thinking like that and declaring God's word over your life instead of accepting what is being thrown at you. The enemy will throw you crumbs. The enemy will throw you gold and silver of this world. They're crumbs compared to a living God. Amen. Know what God is doing in your life. If you don't know what God is doing, don't do nothing until you find out what God is doing. Stand in God. Stand in faith. Hallelujah. And stand right now in the sanctuary. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord, church. Can I have the praise team come up and sing that last song? Hallelujah. Huh? Yeah, come to the altar. Praise the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord, Ricky. Hallelujah. How many got joy in your heart? Amen. Now, I want to make sure it's the right joy. It's not a picture of a girl, right? Unless it's your wife or your wife-to-be. How many got the joy of the Lord? How many believe beyond a shadow of a doubt that if you seek wisdom, you'll get wisdom? Yes. How many believe that God will order your steps because he already has? Yes. He's already ordered the steps. You don't want to go on a detour. Hallelujah. Amen. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Are you ready to sing, church? Team? Yes. Hallelujah. Well, as they play, you need an answer from God. You need God. Stand with you, us to stand with you and get the enemy off of your back. You want to get that fear and that torment gone? And do what this song says and come to the altar.
Bring your sorrows and trade them for joy. From To the altar.
Blessed Heavenly Father, we thank you and we praise you that you are a God that meets us where we're at. You're a God that doesn't throw us away because we failed. You're not a God that throws us away because we've missed the target. You're a God that draws us back in and loves us, puts a robe of righteousness on us, prepares a feast for us. You're a God that's always ready to show us the way of life. We thank you and we praise you, Lord God, as you lead each and every one of us. We thank you for the quickening of your Holy Spirit. We thank you for the word, Father, that is powerful. We give you the praise and the glory that we're being changed from glory to glory and faith to faith. In Jesus' mighty and holy name, amen. Amen. Well, God bless you. Go in the peace, the grace, the mercy of God. And if you're 55 and signed up for the lunch, stay in church. They're going to have it in just